transparent clothing. Transparent clothing. Now, this is interesting. When we say transparent clothing, we're not just talking about one of the odd materials that somebody would wear where you can see through it. We're talking about regular clothing that you and I we would see, or you and I might own. Let me give you an example. For the man, you know, often underneath our thobes, we would have those regular pajamas that you wear with the thobe. You can buy them all over in Medina, anywhere you go, even here in the Islamic bookstores. It's basically considered to be the pants that you wear under your thobe. It's like a uniform. That particular pants, you have to be very careful with it. Because if you pray with that pants alone, without a garment over it, there's a possibility you can nullify your salah. Because, I mean, just take a look at the material. And take a look that when you put on that pants, look at yourself in the mirror and see if you cannot see through it. It doesn't become transparent. You can't see the garments that you're wearing underneath that pants. For the woman, it's things like the shalwar and khamis that a lot of the Pakistani and Indian cultures they wear. And I mean, I've seen this with my own eyes, like subhanAllah, like some khutbas that I've done in other masajids. Like, you'll see the sisters walking out and you can see like their arms, you can see their legs, but they're dressed and they have their hijab on. This here, if that's the case, now the ulama, they say that if you can see the skin color, then the salah becomes invalid. But if you can see the malabis dakhiliya, so like you can see the undergarments through that clothing, but not necessarily the skin color, then the salah is, generally speaking, still intact, but you lose reward for that salah. Again, goes back to perfecting the prayer. See how silly these mistakes are, but how common they happen? They're so silly, they're so simple, you can avoid them so easily with just a little bit of care and attention, but they become so common. So the second one, Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, he mentions here that if a person prays with a t-shirt and that t-shirt exposes the awra of that individual when they go into ruku' or sujood, then the salah needs to be repeated over again. This here, brothers and sisters, you be very shocked. As a matter of fact, you may not be very shocked, because I'm sure as long as you're praying in the masajid, you would have seen and witnessed this with your own eyes. That you'll see like certain people when they come and they pray, they'll wear certain garments or a t-shirt or something. It's so short and it exposes them when they go into ruku' and sujood. This is a carelessness, wallahi, you have to be ashamed of. You have to be ashamed of something like this. Because you're standing amam Rabbul Alameen. You're standing in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. And here you are. You're not just standing in front of Him, but you're involved in an act of worship, and still you're exposing yourself. So again, the author mentions here, this is one of the other errors when it comes to the salah. For the woman, obviously the emphasis of her covering her body in the prayer is much more than the man. Now, what should a woman wear when she's praying? Many of the scholars, especially the scholars of hadith, they emphasize that the woman should wear something that looks or represents a khimar. It should look like a khimar, or it should represent a khimar of some sort. And this is, of course, based on couple of narrations where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions that every ha'id, every menstruating woman, now the hadith here is not talking about a woman who's menstruating, period. It's talking about all women. It's just a term that's used to describe all women. That every single woman should be covered with a khimar. Now the hadith here is not referring to the actual garment that's titled khimar. What it's referring to is that a garment that acts like a khimar. Do you see the difference? This is really important, because some people, they use this narration and they say that a woman, it is haram for you to wear a skirt and pray salah. Or it's haram for you to have baggy pants. And we talked about this in our discussions in the past, if a woman can wear pants or not. And if she wears a baggy pants, you can't see her shape, you can't see nothing, but what she's wearing is really a pants, but you can't pray with it. It has to be a khimar, has to be an abaya, has to be this and that. So they use that same narration, but that's not what the narration is talking about. It's talking about something that should cover like a khimar. It should represent like a khimar, and the whole body should be sealed like what a khimar would do. In that case here, she is free to use whatever garment that she can, that can fulfill that job. What's a khimar? I mean, basically it's that garment from the shoulder down. For some cultures, it's from the head down, and it's a wrap that you put around the body. So she can have this at her access at any time. There are certain materials that she should try to stay away from. The author mentions materials that are predominantly nylon or chiffon. These types of materials are generally very difficult for a woman to cover herself, because on the outside it may look like she's covered, but when she puts that garment on, it may be otherwise. And this all goes back to a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he mentions, سَيَكُونُ فِي آخِرْ أُمَّتِي نِسَاءٌ كَاسِيَاتٍ عَارِيَاتٍ. There will come a time in my ummah that a woman, she will be dressed and at the same time she will be naked. She will be dressed and at the same time she would still be exposed. I'm not one to tell you. You use your own judgment. And Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best. Perhaps we are living in a time like this today. I remember a sheikh told me that he had a student. And this student was a clothing designer. And the student told him that the company that she works for, every single summer, they will sit down and have a meeting. And the subject of that meeting before summer comes is, the designing team would like to figure out which part of the body of a woman they can target to expose this summer. And that's the topic of their meeting until the summertime comes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But perhaps we could be living in that time. That's why I get so many questions. Like, subhanAllah, so many questions of sisters around the world that would always look for that loophole that they can justify certain garments that they can wear. I remember when I went to in Dhaka in Bangladesh to conduct a seminar, and I talked about the same concept. I almost got attacked after the lecture. Simply because some sisters couldn't understand why certain garments that exposed their ankles and that would expose their entire arm, so this whole arm here was exposed, why they couldn't wear that? Why they couldn't wear that in salah? Why they couldn't wear that just in their daily lifestyle? And it was like, it was very difficult to explain these concepts to them. So it's important, brothers and sisters, that we always stick to the Prophet ﷺ and his sunnah when it comes to these matters.